Hello everyone, welcome you all for today's Indian's Psychiatric Rehabilitation Services session. Today's session will be held by Dr. Hareesh Angothu, who is Associate Professor of Psychiatry in Psychiatric Rehabilitation Services. His area of interest is on disability sector and disability assessment and its benefits. In fact, in 2016, NIMHANS has had organized expert consensus committee meeting for assessment of disability. So Dr. Hareesh was the organizing secretary for the meeting. So he has extensive research and knowledge on disability sector and various benefits it entails. So this class will be divided into two parts. So the first part will be on disability assessments, and the second part, which will be next month, will be on the disability welfare benefits.
I'm Dr. Hareesh, working in the psychiatric rehabilitation for the last 4 years. As part of the rehabilitation, what we have observed is that assessment of disability and providing what is rightful for them once they are assessed as having a disability makes a big change in the process of the recovery. It's not a clinical recovery, it's a personal recovery. So personal recovery, I think you all know that how one would recover from the impact of illness, and then how they would like to move on in their life. So what we thought is, like, I had prepared this keeping in mind about mostly the postgraduate trainee students, and to some extent for any other practitioners who may not be much familiar with the new Rights of Persons with Disability Act, this might be useful. So I welcome you all. And so if you look at what is the need for quantification and certification, medical legal purposes where employee versus employer issues will be there to assess probable loss of functionality and to measure compensation in such cases as an authentic document for reasonable accommodation at public and workplaces, to know applicability to various state benefits, reservations in academic and work opportunities for an inclusive society. So in this regard, there are three important legislations that students must be aware. One is that recently enacted RPWD Act, expanded as Rights of Persons with Disabilities Act 2016, National Trust Act 1999, and the previous PWD Act, that is Persons with Disabilities Act 1995, which is now repealed with the new act. The construct of disability, it itself becomes a big discussion, but I just would like to narrate one 1986 publication by Ministry of Welfare at that time under the Government of India, which is now Ministry of Social Justice, which has given it that a difficulty in performing one or more activities, which in accordance with the subject's age, sex, and normative social role are generally accepted as essential. So if you look at here, it appears more in terms of lack of a structure, inability to do a function. So more of it appears from the medical model. But the United Nations Convention on Rights of Persons with Disabilities Act 2006, which has given a definition, a broader definition, following which actually most of the countries have ratified this, and they have incorporated that definition within their legislations. So the UNCRPD gives that disability results from the interaction between persons with impairments and attitudinal and environmental barriers that hinders their full and effective participation in society on an equal basis with others. So just look at the difference between the first and second. Here, the environmental and attitudinal barriers are also, which may amount to poor participation, has been considered as that which would cause a disability. Whereas in the first one, it is only lack of structure or lack of function which would lead to a disability. So to illustrate that, for example, somebody who suffered from a severe mental behavioral disturbance like manic episode. Now, after the manic episode subsidement also, he may have significant difficulties in gaining back job or gaining back acceptance from the place where he is working, and people may reject, not because he is symptomatic, but the experience which they had in their minds, which would determine their attitudes, and he would be not allowed to participate equally with others. Say, for example, there is a job interview where there are five people, and if the employer knows that one among them is having a severe mental illness in the past, there is less likelihood that he would take him in. So that is what now in this definition, it conceptualizes that that is also amounts to disability. So as I said, these are the three acts which are important for you. It may not be as of now necessary for you, but historically it would be important for you to understand this, that disability as per the Persons with Disability Act 1995. In that, there are seven disabilities, specified conditions were described: blindness, low vision, leprosy cured, hearing impairment, locomotor disability, mental retardation, and mental illness. So for mental health professionals, the sixth and seventh, that is mental retardation and mental illness, would be important. You can notice here that two main condition like autistic spectrum disorders or autism, which also would cause a significant difficulties for persons to achieve their participation in the society, it was not included here. So after a lot of lobbying by the Family Caregivers Associations or Autism Trusts, which are working for that, the ministry again has brought up a new thing, that is National Trust Act for Welfare of Persons with Autism, Cerebral Palsy, Mental Retardation, and Multiple Disabilities. So these four are included here, which were not there in the 1995 Act. So coming to the recent Act, that is Rights of Persons with Disabilities Act 2016, if you look at the definitions, there is no separate definition for a disability. However, there is a term called person with disability, which means a person with long-term physical, mental, intellectual, or sensory impairment, which in interaction with barriers hinders his full and effective participation in society equally with others. So as I mentioned earlier, this would look more or like similar to that UNCRPD definition, though it won't use the term environment, but it says the interaction with barriers. Now, what are the barriers that it can be huge? Now, second thing that you should be much aware is that what is a person with benchmark disability? Means a person which with not less than 40% of a specified disability, where a specified disability is described as under section 2ZC. There are certain disabilities which are called as specified, and they are mentioned in the annexer schedule attached to this act. So to just give you an overview, these are the disabilities as per the schedule of RPWD Act. So you can look at, there are around 21 conditions. In addition to that, there will be a mention that any other as notified on time to time. So government, in addition to this 21, can include on a time to time basis when it thinks that it is also a condition which can cause disability. So among these 21, which matters to mental health professionals more are these four: intellectual disability, specific learning disability, autistic spectrum disorders, mental illness related disability. It's termed as mental behavior. The question is, like, who should assess this disability? If you look at the Rights of Persons with Disabilities Act, Section 56 and 57, which deals with this, it narrates that central government shall notify the guidelines for the purpose of assessing the extent of specified disability in a person. And the 757 says that appropriate government shall designate persons having requisite qualification and experience as certifying authorities. So the guidelines for quantification of disability or disability assessment were issued on 4th January in 2018 by Department of Persons with Disability under the Ministry of Social Justice based on the 2016 Act. Subsequently, the state governments, union territory administrations, it has instructed that they shall constitute the medical boards, and in case of any dispute about how to assess are in terms of dispute between the assessment. For example, a medical board, district medical board assesses a particular quantum of disability in a person. The person doesn't agree with that. He has a grievance about the percentage, where he should approach. So finally, the DGHS under the Ministry of Health will be the final authority in case of any clarification or dispute with respect to the assessment. So a few things that you should be more interested to know is that the application and time frame for assessment. So the rules for implementation of the Rights of Persons with Disability Act were issued under the Section 100 on 15th January 2017. In this, the rules 17 to 20 under Chapter 7, they deal with this certificate of disability, which categorically says in these rules that any person with a specified disability, as per that annexer section, may apply in Form 4. That is, there are a series of forms, Form 1 to Form 8, at the end of these rules, which were gazetted by the Government of India. So in that specific Form 4, at either a competent authority of his area of residence or where treatment was approved. And Aadhaar is not mandatory, but if available, no separate residence proof would be required. And if it is not there, separate residence proof should be provided, which is according to the Government of India norms, any residence proof as per that Government of India. Medical authority should issue a temporary or permanent or no disability certificate within a month of receipt of application. This would be important for you to remember, because within a month, this has to be disposed as per the rules notified by the Government of India. And in these rules, it also has been declared that issuance through online platform can be considered by the appropriate government from the date that it would be notified. So as of now, there are certain state governments which already are giving these kind of certificates in a digital platform. So there will be no manual certificates would be issued. And central government is also has started this kind of initiative, which I will give you a little overview at the end of this presentation. Now, coming to these four conditions which I said, first we will talk about the intellectual disability assessment and quantification. Now, if you look at the definition that has been used in these guidelines for assessment of intellectual disability, a condition characterized by significant limitation both in intellectual functioning, reasoning, learning, problem solving, and in adaptive behavior, which covers a range of everyday social and practical skills. Now, how do you diagnose intellectual disability? As per these guidelines, the screened children will be referred to child or clinical psychologist for adaptive functioning and IQ testing. So, for example, this screened children might be detected in a school or in any kind of regular primary health center or in any kind of pediatric OPD where they think that there is a need for further evaluation about the problems in performance or intellectual ability of this child. Now, as per these guidelines, the tools that can be used should be to measure the adaptive functioning VSMS and to measure the IQ Binet-Kamath test BKT or Malin's intelligence scale for Indian children. So only these two are, as per the guidelines, are allowed to use for IQ quantification. Whereas severity of disability is only through VSMS. So BKT and Malin should be used only for quantification of IQ, which has less relevance for severity of disability. This guideline says that severity of disability should be evaluated through adaptive functioning measure, that is only through VSMS, irrespective of what is the IQ or what is the tool that has been used for IQ assessment. So there is a kind of flowchart that has been given in this guidelines itself very clearly, that children seen in OPD are suspected delays or handicaps, or parents or teachers who complain of poor understanding should be assessed by a pediatrician with a detailed neurological examination for any comorbidities like hearing difficulties or any kind of neurological insults. And then assessment by psychologists with specific tests, like as I said, these things. And once ID is diagnosed, the severity assessment would be VSMS. then a certificate would be issued. So then it would be some temporary certificate, or it can be a permanent certificate, which I can give you information a little later. So now the disability calculation by the medical authority. So as I said, that VSMS would be used for quantifying the disability percentage as per this. This might be little different from the PWD Act related quantification. So I'm quoting this 2016 and following that. If you look at that, 0 to 20 will be 100%, 21 to 35 would be severe 90%, VSMS score of 36 to 54. Usually we would say 36 to 49 or 36 to 50, which we would see in the past, which would correspond to 75% disability. But remember that in this guideline, they specifically mentioned that 36 to 54 would amount to a moderate disability, whereas VSMS score of 55 to 69 would be mild, 70 to 84 would be borderline 25%, and VSMS score of 85 or above would be considered as normal. Now, age criteria and certificate validity for intellectual disability. Minimum age for certification for intellectual disability is one completed year. So before that, it cannot be certified. And during the 1 to 5 year age, children should be given the diagnosis of global developmental delay. They should not be labeled as intellectual disability. For children less than 5 years age, the duration of validity would be either 3 years or the age of 5 years, whichever is earlier. So assume that if a person child is diagnosed at the age of 4 years, the validity will expire when the child reaches 5 years of age. Now, children above the age of 5 years should be given the diagnosis of intellectual disability, and the certificate has to be renewed at the age of 5, 10, and 18. The certificate that is issued at the age of 18 would be valid for lifelong. Now, who would be the medical authority for intellectual disability assessment? This consists of 4 members: the medical board, a civil surgeon or MS medical superintendent or chief medical officer, or any other equivalent authority appointed by the government would be the chairperson of the board. There would be a psychiatrist, and there would be a clinical or rehabilitation psychologist. I think what is a clinical psychologist and what is that definition of rehabilitation psychologist, you can find from the Mental Health Care Act, or which has given specific clear qualifications and definitions. The fourth one will be pediatrician or pediatric neurologist, where available, if the person is less than 18 years age. And if the person is more than 18 years age, the board can appoint a physician extra, or psychiatrist himself would be sufficient. I hope you understood about that meant intellectual disability. Now I am coming for the second part, that is the specific learning disability. So these are a group of conditions where there is a deficit in processing language, spoken or written, that may manifest itself as a difficulty to comprehend, or difficulty to speak and write, difficulty to spell or to do mathematical calculations. And it includes such conditions as perceptual disabilities, dyslexia, dysgraphia, dyscalculia, dyspraxia, and developmental aphasia. Or this also similarly, like screening should be by a pediatrician and a clinical rehabilitation psychologist when it is done at a kind of camp level or a school level. And a pediatrician should do detailed neurological, including vision, hearing assessment. This should be followed by IQ assessment by the clinical psychologist using Malin's intelligence scale for children or Wechsler's intelligence scale for children, version 3. So I am also not sure about the rationale why they have chosen Wechsler's intelligence scale for children 3 here. This is as per the published gazette. So, and it categorically states that only if the IQ is above, then SLD assessment should continue further. So if somebody has an IQ less than 85, SLD assessment should not be carried out and SLD certification cannot be issued. Now, method of assessment and validity. So as per these guidelines, this National Institute of Mental Health and Neurosciences, that is NIMHANS, battery shall be applied for a diagnostic test for SLD. So there are some issues with SLD, is that as of now it would give the presence of SLD or no. So this scale or battery, when applied, it would say that whether the person or the child is having a specific learning disability or no, but it won't be able to quantify the percentage of disability like other measures meant for specified disability. So say for example 50%, 45%, 70%, Now, this will not allow that. And second thing is, as of now, it is not readily available and may be obtained from NIMHANS with communicating with the NIMHANS publication department. As I said, only when the IQ is above 85 and it should be certified in children above the age of 8 years. Now, certification would have to be repeated at 14 years of age and 18 years of age. A permanent one be issued at the age of 18 years. One more thing I just would like to add is that this SLD battery is available and in English, Kannada and Hindi. So, for example, somebody who is in a regional language somewhere else, like say Assami, Gujarati, Oriya, whatever it is, Telugu. So now this, there is no SLD battery for them from NIMHANS. So I'm not sure how SLD assessment can be carried out in a child who is continuing his education in his native language. As long as they continue in this English and Hindi, I think this can be applicable. So this is one of the issue. Who would be the medical authority for certifying a specific learning disability? So the chairperson always would be like a civil surgeon, CMO or MS or any other equivalent as appointed by government. The second one would be pediatrician or pediatric neurologist where available, clinical or rehabilitation psychologist, occupation therapist or a special educator or a teacher trained for assessment of SLD. So for this, for example, the teacher trained for assessment of SLD, respective state governments perhaps can issue guidelines about how to define this teacher trained for assessment of SLD. So sometimes if they are finding difficulty, they may even send their teachers for this kind of training and they may recognize them as that trained teacher, because especially there is a huge, I would say that the scarcity of resources is a significant issue to certify these kind of things at a periphery, even at district levels. Now, the third condition, as I said, that students should be more aware as part of, about this act is that ASD, Autistic Spectrum Disorders, they are lifelong neurological conditions which typically appear in the first 3 years of life, which are marked by some pervasive impairments in the areas of social skills and communication. They often associated with hyper or hyporeactivity to sensory inputs. Unusual interest of stereotypical rituals or behaviors may or may not be accompanied by intellectual impairment. How to do disability assessment, autism disability assessment? As I mentioned that this 2016 guidelines which were issued under the Ministry of Social Justice does not contain this one, because this guidelines were issued little earlier. Sorry, 2017 guidelines does not contain this one. Actually, this was issued in 2016, little before the recent guidelines based on the RPWD Act. So this gazette, it contains three annexes. One is inclined diagnostic tool for ASD. The second one is Indian scale for assessment of autism, ISA, and the pro forma for issuance of certificate of disability due to autism. So what is this inclined and ISA tool? Inclined is, as per this gazette, it has to be used as a tool for diagnosing autistic spectrum disorder. So we usually use clinical criteria and diagnostic classifications like ICD or DSM to make a diagnosis of autism. And sometimes we tend to use standardized assessment scales or schedules to make a diagnosis. But as per the law, it is this inclined tool which has to be used to make a diagnosis, and it is the ESA tool which has to be used for quantifying the disability. So in this inclined tool, there are 12 questions about like social interaction, communication, restricted interest, about childhood disintegrative disorder, Rett's disorder. Questions will be like yes or no answers. And if the score for the first 7 questions is 1, that is yes, and 0 for 8 and 9, which correspond to Rett's disorder and CDD, it would be an autism diagnosis. Now, mental health professionals may be not comfortable with this kind of thing, but that is what has been gazetted. So, this is what you have to understand and learn from a legal perspective, I'm saying. Now, the scale that needs to be used for quantification of disability in autism is that ESA, Indian Scale for Assessment of Autism, which is a scale containing 40 items under 6 domains. ESA has been developed, which provides the detailed assessment procedure and tools for assessing the extent of disability with autism beyond 6 years of age. So this again raises a question, like what about the early identification and early intervention? Because the literature or evidence which says that early intervention, early identification can make a significant difference in people in improving their communication patterns or their repetitive behavior or self-injurious behavior or their language, all these things. But it appears to be a gray area because if you cannot use this one, how would you diagnose and quantify disability for somebody? And without quantifying the disability and without certifying that the person has ASD, they will not be eligible for any kind of government-supported welfare benefit programs, even, for example, early intervention. So this is an area perhaps for discussion. Anyway, not relevant for our current context, but I want you to be a little aware of this. Now, validity, that is based on the identification of cases of autism in terms of England tools, certification of autism on the basis of ESA tools shall be issued. Because every person who has been identified as having autism based on the INCLEN may not score enough to be called as benchmark disability when ESA is used. I will just share in the next few slides what is this ESA. So this certificate would be valid for a period of 5 years from those whose disability is temporary and are below the age of 18 years. For those who acquire permanent disability, the validity can be shown as the permanent in the certificate. So ESA scale, as I said, that the 6 domains are there and all the 40 items are spaced across the social relationships and reciprocity, emotional responsiveness, speech, language and communication, the behavior patterns, sensory aspects and cognitive components. So the scoring system for each category, as I said, under the 40 categories, it would be scored from 1 to 5. For example, there is a flapping of hands, right? So it should be scored whether it is rarely or whether it is sometimes, whether it is frequently, mostly or always. Correspondingly, that score should be given. And how would you rate? Like 20% of times, 21 to 40%. So this kind of thing. Or you can sleep like normal for age and socioeconomic background, or whether it is a cause for attention and concern, or that kind of behavior, or that kind of repetitive utterance of language, or the kind of self-injurious behavior, anything. Well, that particular which I said under the 6 domains, the 40 items, whether it is disability, then it would quantify for score 3. And if that symptom is requiring kind of assistance in ADL, then it would be scored as 4. And if the person is completely dependent because of that particular item, then it should be scored as 5. So usually this kind of ESA, how to apply ESA, kind of trainings are provided at NIMH formerly. Now it is called as National Institute of Empowerment of Persons with Disability, Intellectual Disability at Secunderabad. So if somebody is interested in this to get 1 hour day, 2 day training, perhaps they can look at the website of NIEPID where they would advertise once in a while 1 to 2 day workshops on this ESA, and people who are interested may can attend these kind of things. So the test interpretation, as I said, that the disability percentage of subjects are as per the scores. If it is less than 70 on this scale, it should be declared as no autism, but perhaps I would say that no benchmark disability, because no autism, it appears to be a kind of misnomer. We cannot say that it is no autism if somebody just scores 69. So 70 to 106 would be mild autism, that is disability of mild degree, and 107 to 153 would be moderate autism. More than 153 would be severe autism. But 100% disability, there is also, they have in the Gazette, they have issued a table how to give this percentage of disability: 40, 50, 60, 70, 80, 90, 100. So someone who has 71 to 88 score should be given a certificate of 50% disability. Somebody, a child or adult who scores 106 to 123 should be given a disability percentage of 70. And somebody who scores above 158 will receive a certificate of 100% disability due to autistic spectrum disorders. Who is a medical authority for certification of ASD? So a clinical psychologist or a rehabilitation psychologist, a psychiatrist, a pediatrician or general physician as the case may be. In this gazette, it says that the notified authorities have to constitute autism boards, and the autism board should constitute these people and they should issue the certificates. But in my understanding, I did not come across many autism boards, even in many state headquarters or state capitals. So I'm not sure if this autism boards are issuing autism certificates at many places, at least. Now, finally comes to the disability due to mental illness, which I think comes to you on a day-to-day OPD practice, that you may have to understand these concepts much well compared with other three. I would say that all are important. So in this, you need to understand that if you look at the PWD Act 1995, which says that mental illness is anything other than mental retardation. So that definition is there. Now in this new act, it says a slightly different definition. It's a kind of more of medical definition. A substantial disorder of thinking, mood, perception, orientation or memory that grossly impairs judgment, behavior and capacity to recognize the reality or ability to meet the ordinary demands of life, but does not include retardation. So this definition is there in the section 2ZC of RPWD Act 2016. Also, this is the same definition that you will find in the Mental Health Care Act. Ministry of Social Justice Empowerment, as I said that in February 2, this is in 2002. So I think if you recall what I had said earlier is that the PWD Act has come into existence in 1995. And in that itself, mental illness has been recognized as a disability. But how to quantify the disability, there was no way. So even though it was labeled as a disability, the government of India under Ministry of Health and in association with IPS Task Force and in association with NIMHANS, Ministry of Social Justice altogether, they have come up with a tool called for assessment of disability due to mental illness, which is called as IDEAS. So this was for the first time has been gazetted and in 2002 on 18th February. It was not gazetted, sorry. It is notified. It was notified as a guideline for certifying the mental illness related to disability. And in the current act also, it is the same that is being used, current rules also. So as I said that this IDEAS, Indian Disability Evaluation and Assessment Scale, IDEAS, it contains total 5 items, in which one is that self-care, second one is interpersonal relationships, communication and understanding, fourth one would be work, which can encompass areas of employment or housework or education, and the fifth one would be the duration of illness. So how this scoring of IDEAS is done? All four items like self-care, communication, IPR relationships and work domains would be scored on a scale of 0 to 4, where 0 would be no disability or none or absent or negligible, or 1 would be mild, 2 would be moderate, 3 would be severe, 4 would be profound. So it is a kind of subjective assessment by the clinician who rates. That say, for example, somebody who is having poor hygiene and poorly maintaining his clothes and appearance due to illness, then the clinician could give, say, whether it is mildly affecting or moderately affecting the illness, about his ability to maintain self-hygiene. And correspondingly, in the same way that all the four domains should be rated. However, the total score would be 4 items score plus score on the duration of illness, which will be scored like this. If a person has a less than 2 years of duration of illness, it should be scored as 1. 2 to 5 years of illness should be 2. 6 to 10 years should be 3. More than 10 years should be 4. So this is how that global scoring sheet would appear. Like you can see that self-care, IPR, communication and understanding, work, the total score of the 4 items plus duration of illness of score, which as I had mentioned, just like this one, and add that, you will get a global score, which can range from 0 to 20. So how is this disability quantification is being done? As per these guidelines, it says that the total disability score plus duration of illness score would correspond to global disability. If a person has zero, there is no disability. If a person scores from 1 to 6, anywhere in between, it should be called as mild disability, which amounts to less than 40%. If a person scores to 7 to 13, it would be a moderate disability, that is 40 to 70%. And if a person scores 14 to 19, it would be a severe disability, that is 71 to 99. And if a person scores 20, it would be profound disability, that is 100%. So assessment method and validity. Here also something that a little strange, that examination should consist of clinical assessment, application of ideas and our IQ assessment. In cases where a person may have ID and mental illness, both shall be used. The score indicating more severe disability should be the degree of disability of that person. So both, if a person has both intellectual disability and mental illness, the scores should not be combined, because it says that the score which is with severe disability will be the disability of the person. Now, one more interesting thing is that we have seen in both the ASD, SLD, intellectual disability, everywhere about the validity of the certificate. Now, the current gazette is silent on this validity. There is no mention. So, left for interpretation. Second thing, that is, there is no clear mention on the intermediate percentage, like 45% or 50%, 60%, sometimes we see in certificates. Look at, this is the only thing that has been given in the gazette. So, but if we issue some 40 to 70% disability for a disability certificate, now there can be a significant challenge for the person to get a social welfare benefit, because the person sitting in the social welfare office would not be comfortable with this range of disabilities. They want a particular percentage. I don't know whether that is, there is reason why most of the medical boards issue a specific percentage based on the global score multiplied by 5. So often I have seen that if a person scores 10, the person would receive a 50% disability certificate. If a person scores 12, he would receive a 60% disability certificate. But there is no mention of such kind of a calculation in the gazette. And how long should the board should give? Say 2 years, 1 year, 6 years, permanent? There is no mention. As per the discretion of the clinician and medical board, and if they feel that the mental illness, the disability can be permanent, then they can give that permanent. If they think that the person has to be reassessed after some time, it can give in the same temporary format. So one more thing that you should be aware is that the multiple disability. So if a person has more than one disability, say, even if you are dealing with mentally ill persons, they may have other comorbidities. Now we have seen that there are 21 conditions. So any other condition which may be described as a specified disability, then he would benefit in combining those, because he gets additional percentage of disability, which may help him in getting access to some other social welfare benefits or schemes which are provided by the appropriate state governments or any central government. So the formula is like A plus B multiplied by 90 minus A divided by 90. This actually was used for quantification of disability due to loss of two structures in orthopedic cases. But this has been directly brought to the disabilities also. But maximum total percentage of multiple disabilities shall not exceed 100%. So it's a small example. This itself has a issue with this formula. But for your understanding, maybe you can just look at this. If a person has 30% and 20%, then it would lead to a combination of 43% disability. But this cannot be used, as I said, for a person who has intellectual disability as well as mental illness. Few conceptions and gray areas I thought I can discuss with you, that which disorders to be assessed. So can substance use disorders be certified? And one of the second question that often would come in discussion is when to assess. What if a person is not under treatment, or he is never treated, or should he be evaluated for a disability during the acute phase of illness, or during the IP care, or after discharge for 3 months, or after discharge for 6 months? When? And for how long one should issue the duration of validity? When to issue a temporary certificate and when to issue a permanent certificate? So there are no definitive answers for this. But you should be aware that one thing which I had mentioned in the initial presentation, that any medical board is bound to do disability assessment and certification in a period of less than 1 month once it receives the application for disability assessment. So there can be legal issues if some clinician says that I cannot certify this person because I don't think that he is on treatment for a long time enough. So the clinician or the medical board has only three choices once the application comes: to say that the person does not have a specified disability, or the person have specified disability but it falls less than 40%, or they can say that the person has specified disability and according to the guidelines this is the percentage of disability. But I don't think that this person is not on treatment and he has not an adequate treatment. These things perhaps would have difficulty when it is brought to the legal scrutiny. So one more thing just I wanted to give you a little overview is that the platform which I had told you in the initial, that now Government of India is coming with the online platform that is called Unique Disability ID Card under the Ministry of Social Justice. So this is a platform where any person who is desirous of getting unique ID can apply. The process is that online application from home that can be done simply, application of a fresh disability certificate or application for the verification of previously issued disability certificate. So there are two categories. If I already have a manual certificate which has been issued by somebody else in the past, I can scan it and upload, or I can apply saying that I have never been evaluated, please do evaluation. The application would be redirected to the competent medical authority of the area where the person resides. Few challenges like digital literacy and access to digital gadgets for many people. We know that many people may not have, they are good at using these kind of things like scanning and limiting the data to 50 KB, because these kind of restrictions will be there. You have to upload your certificate in less than 50 KB. Sometimes even I find difficult. So people who have very poor digital literacy, I think it will be difficult. And as of now, there is no such mechanism where people can approach in a kind of kiosk. There are some at some places by enthusiastic professionals, and poor accountability and grievance redressal mechanism under this current format. So if somebody applies for, I have met several people who have applied 6 months back. Ideally, it should be processed within 1 month. Now they are not sure where to approach. If they approach the online forum, they are getting information that we are not the people who are assessing, so you wait for your call. When they approach nearby hospital also, they would not get a kind of warm response, and so it needs to be streamlined. This is one of the challenges that I think systems are right now trying to work, some people in this. So as per the current today's UDID webpage, which displays that as of now they have around 72,88,000 applications that they have received. So huge number, right? So thank you. I hope I had given you the information pertaining to these four conditions, which is more relevant for you from both exam perspective as well as practice perspective.
Good afternoon, sir. I am Nitin from Hyderabad. So yes. This was a recent discussion that if an adult walks into a clinic and asks us for a disability certificate for his SLD, so can we issue a certificate after 18 years?
See, as of now, as I said that the competent authority to issue that certificate which will have legal validity would be that constituted medical board. Now, if I am a private practitioner, I can issue in my handwriting saying that I believe that this person has specific learning disability. But in terms of access to social welfare things, or in terms of access to any other benefits, the government authorities will not recognize that. They would want a board certificate. So this may be an accessory when they go for a board evaluation, saying that, see, I had consulted a private practitioner who said that I am having specific learning disability, so I want a formal assessment and certificate. So it will help in that kind of, as a kind of adjunct, rather than in any way to get access to social welfare benefits. And whether to give it or not in that format, it is up to the discretion. Some people will say that they will issue with a specific fee. Some will say that they will not issue.
Can we give SLD in adults, sir, or it has to be diagnosed during childhood and then continue to adults, or can we give it directly to an adult?
So, I would like to discuss one other thing, that this SLD battery, which they gazetted in the NIMHANS, that itself has normative data only up to 12 years of age. So, the battery doesn't have normative data for beyond that. But SLD, the certification in the Gazette, it says that it can be certified up to the age of 18 years, and a certificate given at the age of 18 years is permanent. But what if somebody comes at the age of 25 years saying that I was never evaluated because I never had access, but all through my childhood I had suffered from specific learning disability, now kindly do assessment and issue a certificate. Now this is a very gray area. We don't have any right answer and we don't have any tool for that.
Sir, as per the current gazette, sir, for SLD, sir, we are not a qualified person who can give a certification, sir. But, sir, currently in clinical setup, what is the scenario? Are psychiatrists in a stand to give a certification for SLD, or we cannot, sir?
See, I think it is the same kind of question which Dr. Nitin earlier has asked. So, I don't find anywhere any law which prevents any clinician giving in writing what is their opinion. So if a psychiatrist in his opinion feels that the child in front of him suffers from a specific learning disability, then he can give it as a kind of certificate. Yes, there's no problem with that. He can give. But the terms of validity in terms of what the, for example, a person who seeks SLD, they would seek it for a specific purpose, right? So they may seek for exemption, say one language, they may seek exemption from mathematics, they may seek some kind of extra time in exams. So they will have a purpose. Now that purpose may not get served if it is done by a psychiatrist in a simple assessment. It has to be done by a constituted medical board.
Good afternoon, sir. So I wanted to ask if, like, a permanent disability has been issued, or say like a patient of schizophrenia is there who has been issued a disability certificate, but with the course of time, if improvement is there, could the permanent disability be re-challenged? And second question is, in the patients like of very severe anxiety is there or agoraphobia is there, that is limiting the activity of the person. So in that case, can disability be issued to them?
Yeah. Regarding the first question, I think if the certificate states that, medical board certificate states that the disability due to schizophrenia is permanent, then who would challenge that? A person perhaps would get benefit out of that, or his family would be comfortable with that. So they may not challenge that. Who would challenge is the question, first thing. Second thing is, even if they challenge, it is a challenge against the medical board's decision. Because medical board felt that even though the mental illness is a kind of dynamic condition, they felt that in this person, the disability is likely to be permanent. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, they would have given only 2 years validity or 3 years validity. So once the board it certifies, the challenge can be done at the next higher level. That is, if the assessment has been carried at a district level, then it can be challenged at state level. As I said, in any dispute, DGHS under Ministry of Health is the final authority in terms of validity or in terms of the percentage. So that is for the first question. Now, second question is in terms of severe agoraphobia, which is limiting a person's ability to participate. Yes, that itself is a limitation, and it amounts to disability. If I am a clinician where I feel that my patient is having severe agoraphobia and I feel that the person's a significant limitation is there and he is disabled, I am entitled to give a disability certificate due to agoraphobia. Yes, so I can give. Only whether I am willing to give or not is one issue. Because I found much discomfort in many clinicians when they look at conditions which are not psychotic or which are not traditionally called as chronic conditions. So also they several reasons, but theoretically, as per the rules, yes, it can be given.
So if I can add,
yeah,
the confusion also arises from the earlier proposal from the rehabilitation task force from IPS, which had originally designed ideas to be certified for only four conditions. So the earlier some of the articles also mentioned that only four conditions can be certified for disability according to IDS. But when it got notified in 2002, it included all mental illnesses. So all mental illnesses would include GAD, agoraphobia, dissociative disorders, any disorder which is covered in ICD or DSM will be eligible to get a disability certificate. The confusion is because initially, and many of us also have read that original proposal and those articles and feel that only four disabilities, that is to say schizophrenia, bipolar disorder, OCD and
dementia.
So only four are to be given. It is not so. The gazetted version, the notification says all disorders can be issued disability certificate. The question is, when we apply IDS, whether the person will get more than 40% of disability. If the person gets more than 40% of disability scores, if we apply IDS, then sure, we'll have to issue the certificate.
Hello, sir. I want to ask whether we can assess epilepsy on the IDS, because as you just said, most of the patient, when I work in government setup, we find patients with epilepsy and they have some form of behavioral disturbances. So can we assess those patients and certify them as disabled?
I'm afraid perhaps we cannot apply this for simple epilepsy. But however, if there are any kind of consequences, say for example, cognitive deficits, which may amount to a kind of organic dementia or organic personality change or anything which fits for mental disorder diagnosis, then you may be justified. But simple epilepsy diagnostic label and applying IDS, I won't recommend, because that would raise questions and it would be very difficult to justify.
Yes, sir, I understand. But the issue comes when most of the patients, when they are post-traumatic patients, they have some form of cognitive decline. And they are also on a few anti-epileptics and they have some form of disability. So the patient, they keep on asking, they should be certified. So in that situation, what we should do?
That's what I was suggesting, that if you think that there are severe cognitive deficits which would amount to cause more than 40% disability, then along with epilepsy, you also need to consider other organic diagnosis, like F0 conditions, where you can consider that organic dementia or change related to this one. Even if, for example, somebody who has some kind of post-trauma and part of the brain has been resected, and following that, the appropriate label would be organic dementia. So if you think that the person would fit for that, then you would be justified. But just because somebody is having repeated episodes and he is on medication, then only purely based on the epilepsy diagnosis, I would not recommend it. No.
So my question was, while calculating, assessing for duration of illness in IDS, while applying IDS, so what should be taken as the total duration? If suppose our patient of psychotic illness had just two episodes, almost 5 years apart. So will it be total 6 years or just the two episodes during which he was symptomatic?
Yeah, this also we have discussed extensively with many experts in this group when we made some kind of national level expert consensus meet. So to Chetan was also giving you information that originally when IPS task force and these people have devised this scale, initially the proposal was that the number of months in the preceding 24 months when the person was symptomatic. So if the person is 6 months symptomatic or 12 months symptomatic or say 24 months symptomatic was the criteria which was used for quantification of disability. But when it was notified, it was very silent on that. And duration of illness we also have come across on several situations about how to do that. For example, a person had suffered from one episode of mania in 2005, and now in the 2019, he comes back with the second episode. Though he has suffered only for 3 months illness, should we quantify him as more than 10 years, which would give him a score of 4? So it is a vague area left for the discretion of the medical board. There are two viewpoints here. One is that a person might have been symptom free, but he might have been subject to the discrimination because of the illness, like stigma, which also would have caused him disability during this period. The second thing is that sometimes, whether it is even bipolar, even when we say that clinically symptomatic, they tend to be having a mild symptoms which may affect their participation to their full extent. So in that way, there are people who advocate that once a diagnosis of severe mental disorder is made, even though he is maintaining well on medication or without medication, so-called maintaining well, they would prefer in combining the total years that he has suffered, because he has received that mental illness label and he was treated as a person with mental illness in the community, which sometimes amounts to several exclusions and discriminations if it is a severe mental illness. Now, there is another argument which will say that I will not consider that is symptom-free period. I will look at only this one. And if I have kind of only evidence that he had suffered all through this period, then I would consider. So it is subjective discretion of the clinician. It's a gray area. There are two arguments. But I have seen many people who would take it at total duration since the time of onset of illness.
Good afternoon. I just want to know, you mentioned about the NIMHANS battery, but what about DALI, Dyslexia Assessment for Languages of India? Can that also be used for certification?
The purpose of certification, it becomes important. That's what I said. So if somebody, a clinical psychologist or a counselor or a private practitioner who wants to give some kind of certificate, they can use whatever the tool that they are interested in, and they can give the opinion what they think in their understanding. So there is nothing that which prevents from doing what they want. But when it comes to access to facilities as per the government norms, then it has to be issued in the format given by the government of India by the appropriately constituted medical board.
Thank you, sir. Thank you all the participants for actively participating and asking questions of their doubts. I would like to place our sincere thanks to Linux Laboratories for their support through educational grant.